How much do you see of the world around you? Does it feel like a big video? That you have lots of color, lots of detail everywhere you look? Sometimes it seems like our eyes are actually high-definition cameras, taking in all this information at one time. But in the few seconds you've been listening to me, you've really only seen a tiny fraction of that world around you. Most of what we see comes through the very central part of our eye called the fovea, and that's about as big as your thumb at arm's reach. That has basically all the color sensors, all the detail for any fine lines, and everything outside of that area is very, very blurry. Take reading, for instance. When we look around in a page, looking at words and paragraphs, our eyes flick from point to point, picking in words and phrases to construct a sentence. But if you look just to the side of a word, say you look at the dot on the right-hand side here, and keep your eyes fixed on that, but then shift your mind so it's looking at the word itself, you'll find that it's blurry, it's almost unintelligible. Everything we get is really from that center, and the rest of it is a big blurry mess. So how is it that I can see the rest of the world in a big, clear way in which I currently do? Well, neuroscientists and philosophers would say that you're extrapolating, you're adding a great deal of information from your memories, from your expectations and predictions, to that small amount of vision that you have. And how does that work? Well, think about when you walk into a new room. First of all, what you do is you intuitively look around at the boundaries of the room and the major objects that are there, and you form a spatial map. This is the basis of what you're fitting your vision onto. So my eye then, once I've got this map, my eye will start to look around at little details, so faces, text, dynamic objects. It could be argued that the majority of what you see, almost all of what you see, is actually this construction of space around you, and you're only putting little bits and pieces on top, and that's the basis of vision. For the 40 million or so blind people around the world, this is a serious problem. The amount of visual information that comes in for a blind person is so little that it's very, very hard to construct this spatial map. What a lot of people will do is they'll listen to the echoes of a wall, or they'll use a cane to find objects, or the small amount of sight that they might have remaining in order to produce this visual map. But that can be very exhausting, and the result can be very poor. So what I tried to do with my work is I've tried to think about ways in which you can provide that spatial information so that a person with only the smallest amount of sight can still produce a visual field that they feel comfortable in, that adds rich meaning to their lives, and they can feel confident and secure. Now, one of the ways to help you do this is that the majority of people who we'd call blind actually have some sight. So about 8 out of 10 people have what you call residual vision. And this can be a small amount of visual sight anywhere in their field. If you have tunnel vision, you've lost all your periphery, you just have a small amount, like a keyhole in the center. If you've got macular degeneration through age, you'll lose your central vision, it'll expand out, and you'll have vision around the outside. So what I've been doing in my lab is looking for ways in which we can find simple, relevant information, visual information, and present that in ways that are going to be able to produce that sense of space that many of us, most of us probably, take for granted. It's a benefit in some respects. We have this great brain that's able to produce details and tell people from the smallest amount of information. Say like classic emoticons. A small amount, a few lines in just the right spot, and your brain can say that that's a person, they've got a particular expression. This is particularly handy for us because when we started to look at this, we were just representing the world in the simplest of ways. So let me show you a couple of works that we've done. This was the first system that we made that was trying to produce a level of sight for people who are blind. And what we do is it's really the intersection between what you'd call augmented reality and computer vision. So augmented reality is about getting information from the visual world and putting it into your field and seeing the world through this filter. Computer vision is about finding ways in which computers can understand the world around you. Now, all of us in our pocket and in our handbag will have relatively sophisticated computers with the ability to detect barcodes and faces and text. But they're not going to be able to find the general objects that you find, like cars and carrots and cabbages and things like that. So we had to think about, is there a more general way in which we can start to understand the world and make a visual field? Around this time, Microsoft came out with a camera called the Kinect, which was designed for video games and obviously unicorns. What we did, we strapped one of these to a headset and drove it through some LED lights and mounted it onto some ski goggles. And what we do is we're able to represent nearby objects as big, bright regions of light. So in this video, you can see my coworker Ian as he walks across in front. The camera detects him, and his representation is there. You can even see him wave his arms if you look carefully. The trick is, with blindness, to get rid of all the background and just show a couple of things really clearly. So we built this system, and we were able to test it with a number of visually impaired people, and we were very nervous because we didn't know what people would make of it, whether they'd be able to see anything or not. The first person came through, had such little sight that only in a really bright room was she able to see a person who was about that far away. After looking at these for a couple of minutes, she was able to see people 4 or 5 meters away and tell when they were moving their hand. A person came in later in the afternoon who had a guide dog and only had a small amount of central vision, could see very little. And after a few minutes of using our glasses, these glasses, if you can call them that, he could look down and he said, "There you are, girl," to his guide dog. For our small research group, this was amazing. It gave us the strength and the validation to know that we can potentially augment vision for people who are blind and partially sighted. What we need to do is work on how to make something which is going to be richer, easier to wear, better looking. And so we went back to the lab. Several years later, what we'd come up with is our fifth version, our Mark V. So this is the version that we currently use for testing. It's far more elegant than the previous one. Has a battery pack, which can last for half a day or so. Some of the special things are, it's got a see-through display. So a person can look through and use their sight as they normally would, but has these little invisible mirrors and projectors which are able to present a digital image right in the middle of your field of view. We have a sophisticated camera system that can detect objects nearby, and we've gone deeper into computer vision to work out better ways of representing the world. So rather than just a bank of LEDs, now we have a richer video image where we've been able to outline the boundaries of an object to make them even easier to see. And this has allowed people to really focus on the objects that are right in front and ignore all the background. It's also allowed people who are very, very sight impaired to start to see faces. And now we can represent a face like a cartoon, drop away all the background, and allow a person to focus on the things that are most important to them. We particularly built this system so that we could do a lot of home testing. We've loaned it out to about 70 people or so in the last few months to find out what it's like when they take it home. Does it actually work in their real life? And the results have been remarkable. We've had people report that with these glasses, they've been able to feel more safe and more in control of their environment around them, so building up that sense of space around them. Another person reported that they were able to go out and socialize more, that the last few weeks have changed their life completely, that they've been out more than they have in the last few years. And really, it's that emotional connection as well. And one of our testers has said that he hadn't seen his daughter's faces for many years, but being able to sit around the dinner table and see them was a phenomenon. So you can really see how this sort of technology can really make a strong difference to a lot of people's lives. The proof of principle is there, but obviously the whole thing isn't finished yet. We've got issues with, it doesn't work for everybody. So if you've got macular degeneration, late stage, and not much vision in the center, it's very hard to see these displays, but we're working on ways to get around that. There's also the look and feel. I mean, I think they look fantastic, but enough people have said that they're bulky, yeah, and we know that. And one of my favorite quotes was, "They look awful." So, you know, you can put all the science in as you can, but, you know, you've still got to make things look good. So we're thinking a lot about how to develop this further, how to make sleeker versions. And as computers get better and technology gets smaller, there's a lot of ways to do that. But what our lab is looking at a lot more now is the computer vision component. So rather than just detecting things and making them high contrast, what we're starting to look at is some of the work around in artificial intelligence, about how you can detect objects of a particular type, like a semantic class of object, and whether that's something that you can use then to personalize these glasses, allowing them to grow with you, to understand the type of common things that an individual person would have. And we've come up with this idea we call extended cognition, which is your glasses aren't just there to magnify the objects in front, but they're there to become a personal extension of how you see the world. As an example, here's a picture of my daughter taken the other day on at Barnes near where I live. She's just there with her bike. The photo's actually quite poorly lit. We run that through a neural net classifier, which detects certain class of objects and highlights them to the background. What we're able to do is find the person. So here she is labeled as a person. Her bike is labeled as well. And you can see that with this type of technology, what we're able to do is not just highlight stuff because it's nearby, but really start to look at the less objects in the world that people really want to be able to focus on. So this can potentially help visually impaired people in a vast way of areas, but we're also really interested to see what we can do, whether this technology will actually be useful for everybody else. Like, would you want a system where you're able to detect people in the crowds, people at a conference that you're sure you know, but you can't really remember? Or looking for ingredients in a supermarket for a new recipe you're trying out? Or maybe there's a range of different experiences that we haven't even thought of yet, but we can use this technology for, such as looking into different spectrum of light, like x-rays or magnetic fields, or putting information on historical sites so you get a richer experience of that. And one thing I'm personally particularly interested in is looking at the development of 3D space and how you can get other people to share that with you, maybe people who are far away or lost in time. The field of augmented vision is really expanding, and what makes me really happy about this is that visually impaired people, in this case, are the first ones who are going to be able to benefit. So often when new technologies come along, it's built for the masses, and it takes years for them to adapt, for people with difficulties to be able to use them. But in this case, it's visually impaired people who get to try them first, and it's really their experiences that will shape everyone else's. Thank you.